Again, a pleasant morning to all of you, my dearly beloved brothers and sisters in Christ. It is an honor for me again to be sharing God's words to all of you today. And thank you for reading that our scripture reading this morning. And I would just like to go over it again, particularly, again, in Matthew chapter 7, particularly in verse 9 and in verse 10. Let me just read it again to you. In verse 9, which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you, then though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to you, to those who ask him? Now, having read that and having said that, we will be talking this morning about the goodness of our Lord and how good He is. And this morning, we will discuss one of the most quoted phrase out there today, both in the religious and the secular world. And that phrase is, God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. So, the title of our lesson for this morning is aptly that God is good all the time. Or, there's a little question down there, or is He really? So, that will be our lesson for this morning. According to an article I read a couple of weeks ago, there's a prison somewhere in Zambia which was built in 1950 to house 250 men. But today, it holds over about 1,300 prisoners. The cells which were built to hold 50 are now home to over 150 men. So thrice the number. So they are locked into these small cells from 8 in the evening till late in the morning. Now cellmates will have to take turns lying down or sitting to sleep, or if you can, you know, if you can sleep standing up, it's all up to you. But you can probably visualize the situation they are in. You can somehow see, you know, you can somehow even smell the odor, you know, and the heat in those cells must be almost unbearable. If a prisoner is healthy, it won't be long that he will get infected with tuberculosis, pneumonia, and even AIDS. In that prison, there was a certain Christian, a Christian minister. He was accused of an offense. And he was leading the Sunday service every Sunday. And in one particular service, his opening line was that God is good. And all the time, God is good. Oh, God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. You know, just wow. Here's a man locked in a prison hell. Not in a prison cell, but a prison hell, who has no idea if he will ever get out, still had an absolute confidence in the goodness of God, declaring amongst his prison mates that God is good all the time. That minister would probably be one in a thousand or one in a million ratio. But later on in our lesson, I will reveal a secret why this preacher was still able to say God is good all the time, even in his appalling situation in prison. Now, if I may call your attention into your social media accounts, your Facebook, your Twitter, your Instagram, you will see so many people posting the phrase God is good or any of its equivalent. Now, I want to show to you another slide. How about So what if we got a good job? We say God is good. What if we got promoted at work? We say God is good, right? When you have a new car, we say, oh, wow, God is really good. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Right? What if we passed the licensure exam? Your son, your daughter passed the licensure exam. Probably they were posting in their social media account, God is really good. If there is a new baby on the way, we say, God is good. If we got a new gadget, like during your birthdays or in the holiday season, you got to receive a new gadget, a new cell phones, or a new toy, people would post it in their YouTube or in their Facebook account, God is good. If a person was healed from his sickness, he will post, God is good. All the time, and all the time, God is good. If you survive an accident without any scratch whatsoever, you will say, God is good. Now, the question is, how about these things? How about these things? What if I remain jobless? You still are jobless. How about if you got terminated from work? How about you had a total car wreck? Can you still say God is good? Can you post that in your social media account, in your Facebook account? I'm still jobless. God is good. Can you post that? How about if you failed three times, not once, not twice, but three times in your bar exam, in your board exam? Can you still post that in your Facebook account and say, you know, I failed my exam three times. God is good. Can we still do that? How about if you lost your baby during the delivery? How about if you received nothing for birthday or holidays? How about if you got a cancer? Your body is deteriorating because of your sickness, because of your cancer. Can you still post that and say, God is good? And how? What about if you have an accident and you have a 50-50 chance due to that accident? Can you still say, God is good? Now, the question still remains, is God still good all the time? With all the things I just mentioned, is God still good all the time? Somehow, there are really, really two sides of the coin. One is that God is good when things go our way, while on the other side, let me see. Well, God is not so good after all when things did not go our way. Now, here's a point to ponder. If God's goodness then is based on how we perceived it, then God is evil to those who have cancer. God is evil to those who got COVID-19 and died. God is not good to those who lost their jobs. And God is not good to those who shut down their businesses. Now, I want you to think over that, to ponder that. People would say that God is not good. My son, my daughter, my wife died of COVID-19. So for them, probably God is not good. Again, if God's goodness then is based on how we perceived it, then God is evil to those people. But here's the point. Here's the point. God is God, whatever you think. First point, God is God, whatever you think. Second point, God's goodness is based on his character, not on your perception, what you and I think about him. So God's goodness, again, is based on his character, not on our perception. And third point, that God is good all the time, no matter what your circumstances might be. God is good. Even you like him or not, God is good. God is good. Whatever your life's circumstances right now, his goodness is not based on whatever your life circumstances. His goodness is not based on how we perceive him to be. His goodness is based on who he is. His goodness is based on his character. And God is good all the time, period. You know. Now, here's the challenge. The challenge is, how can I take away this perception of mine that God is not good when life circumstances doesn't favor me? And how can I truly accept and say with absolute confidence that God is good all the time? How can I say that? How can I take that away? My perception when things go wrong. That's the challenge. And here's the solution. The solution is, in order to understand God's goodness, we need to strengthen our view about God. We need to strengthen that. And we do this with two things. Number one, search the scriptures and know the truth. Know the truth. That's really important. And number two, learn who God is. By knowing these two, we will solve, or we will find the question, we will find the answer, rather, to the challenge that I presented a while ago. So, in knowing the truth, we will take, for example, debt. The scenario or the question about debt. Somehow, we blame God for the death of a loved ones. We raise our voices to God in anger when our children in their young age died. We have this resentment in God and ask him, why, God, why? Why did you let my son die? Why did my wife die? Why did my wife contracted with COVID and died? So by learning and by searching the scriptures and by knowing the truth, somehow it will give us a clear idea on what truly the goodness of God is. Now, it is sad indeed to lose someone, and we cry and we empathize with them. We empathize with people, we sympathize with them. But by knowing the truth about death, our anger, our resentment with God will be eliminated, and the healing process will be somehow quicker, and the demise of our loved ones would be easily accepted. You know, this is just one of the many examples that I can share with you. But in knowing the truth, I'm just going through the example of death. The truth about death, and the truth about death is that in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Again, I'm just taking one example in the scriptures about knowing the truth. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, we will uncover five truths in this scripture alone. The Bible said, it is appointed for man to die, and after this, or it is appointed for man once to die, and after this, the judgment. Now, point number one, the Bible said it is appointed. Death is unavoidable, right? That's the number one point. It is appointed, meaning it is unavoidable. In general, point number two, the Bible said it is appointed for man. It means that there is no exception. All of us would face death. Now, point number three, that verse says wants to die. It is appointed for man wants to die, meaning that we only die once, meaning we live only once and die after. The moment that you and I were born, that's the time, that's the moment that we will have to face judgment. That's the moment wherein we will die. A person who is not born will never face death because he was born. But a person like you and I, we only die once. We live once and we die once. And in point number four, the Bible said it is appointed for man once to die. And after this, meaning there is something after death. It is not the end. After my life here on earth, the Bible said, and after this, there is something more, right? There is something after death. And what comes after, the Bible said, this, the judgment. It is appointed for man once to die, and after this, the judgment. The judgment, point number five, is our final destination. So therefore, if I die, there is this final destination that I will go to, whether I go where the Lord is in heaven or in hell. Now, the truth about death, knowing the truth, having known the truth about death, that all of us will face death, somehow will give us an idea that death would come to each and every one of us, and that death is in the Bible, and that you and I will soon face the judgment of the Lord. So knowing the scriptures, knowing the truth, for example, knowing the truth about death, it will somehow make us feel us more comfortable knowing that the death of my loved ones being with the Lord will give me comfort that that person will go to where my God is. Now, number two. Now, knowing the scriptures, knowing the truth, and number two, know who God is. Before we can say that God is good all the time and all the time that God is good, we need to know who God is. And the Bible said we can find that God is a sovereign God. He is sovereign. And by sovereign, we mean that he is supreme in power, great, he is omnipotent, he is omniscient, and he is omnipresent. He's everywhere. And when we say sovereign, I will use the word control, that God is in control. There's absolutely nothing that happens in this world that is outside of God's influence and authority. And God is without limits. And we can find that in Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 17. The Bible said, "Our Lord God, it is you who made the heavens and the earth. By your great power and by your outstretched arm, nothing is too hard for you." Nothing is too hard for God. Now, being sovereign, part of being his being sovereign, the sovereignty of God, is he will do according to his purpose as he pleases. Isaiah 46, verse 10, the Bible said, "My purpose will stand, and I will do all that I please." And it was re-echoed by Paul in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11. Paul said, "Works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will." So part of his sovereignty, that he will do anything in accordance to his purpose and as the Lord pleases. And part of his purpose, or part of his sovereignty, is that no one can stop God in doing his purpose. In Job chapter 42, verse 2, we can read that I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. No, whatever God wants to do, nobody can stop. Nobody can stop the Lord. Nobody can thwart what he wants to do in accordance, again, to his purpose. And again, part of his sovereignty is that no one can question his purpose. No one can blame the Lord. In Daniel chapter 45, we read, he, the Lord, does as he pleases with the powers of heaven and the peoples of the earth. No one can hold back his hand or say to him, what have you done? Lord, what have you done? Lord, what have you done to my family? Lord, what have you done to us? Daniel is explicit when he said that no one can hold back the hand of God and say to him, God, what have you done? Or look, what have you done? No one can say that to God, because part of his sovereignty is that he will do whatever in accordance with his purpose and as he pleases. Now, let me go to, there are these three individuals in the Bible that I want to go over. And let me just find my slides, right? Okay. Now, three individuals in the Bible who had so many difficulties, who had so much troubles in life, who had so many trials, and still, in their actions, they say that God is good all the time. Let's go now to the example of Job. In the example of Job, in Job chapter 2, verse 9 and 10, we read that Job's wife said to him, do you still retain your integrity? Curse God and die. But Job replied, you are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble? In all this, Job did not sin in what he said. His wife wanted him to curse God for all his misfortunes, everything, in just a snap of a finger, everything was lost, his fortune, everything. But Job's wife asked him and pleaded with him to curse God and die. But Job replied to her, shall we accept good from God and not trouble? Now, in Job chapter 1, particularly in verses 20 to 22, wonderful things happen. And let me read to you. At this, Job got up and tore his robe and shaved his head. Now, he did this after learning that he lost everything. So, Job got up, tore his robe, and shaved off his head. Then he fell to the ground in worship. Can you imagine losing everything, losing all that you work for, losing all that you have in life? You know what Job did? First thing that he do after shaving off his head, what he did was so great. What he did is he fell to the ground. He fell to the ground. He kissed the ground. His chest was on the ground. And he worshiped the Lord. Can we still worship the Lord if we lose everything? But Job did. And Job said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. Wow. Just wow. May the name of the Lord be praised. And the Bible said, in all this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. how can this person, you know, I was thinking, how can this person who loses everything and still did not question God, did not charge God of wrongdoing, and still he was able to worship God. He fell on his face, he fell to the ground and worshiped the Lord. Just wow. Now, another example would be Joseph. Joseph the dreamer. In Genesis chapter 45, verses 7 and 8, but God sent me ahead of you. This was Joseph talking to his siblings. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. Therefore, it was not you who sent me, but God, who has made me a father to Pharaoh, lord of all his household, and ruler over all the land of Egypt. And in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20, as for you, what you intended against me for evil, God intended for good, in order to accomplish a day like this, to preserve the lives of many people. Well, we all know what happened to Joseph. He was sold, he was mistreated, he was thrown into prison, he was accused of wrongdoings. But you know, in all these things, like Job, he did not accuse God. He didn't charge God of wrongdoings. He did not curse God. He did not question God. Lord, what happened to me? Look what you did to my life. I became miserable because of you. No, he never did question God about that, but still kept the faith, move on, having that faith, that true faith in the Lord. Now, let's move on to Paul, our third example. Now, in Paul's case, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 to 10, or because of these surpassingly great revelations, therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Now, we can see the example of Paul. Three times he asked the Lord, he pleaded to God to take away his thorn in the flesh. But the Lord, no, he didn't take it away. Why? Because he wanted to teach Paul a very important lesson. And what is that? That God's grace, that Jesus' grace is sufficient for us, and for his power is made perfect in weakness. Paul did not blame God. Paul did not question God. Paul did not resent against God. And look at what Paul said in verse 10. I delight in weaknesses, in insult. I took delight in hardships. I took delight in persecutions. I took delight in difficulties. I took delight. For when I am weak, then I am strong. You know, three men of God of different age in the history in the Bible, all of which suffered a great deal of troubles, persecutions, trials, of many sorts, of which probably many of us have not encountered in our lifetime. But despite of it all, they all continue to be faithful to God, glorified and worship God. And through their actions, speaking louder than their words, showed that God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Now, let me just boast about God a little furthermore. You know, let me tell you about this story. I met this person in our Good Vibes FB Live program about last year. I was just able to talk to him personally last December when he called me up and told me that he's been following and watching the program for years and that he found Jesus again in his life. And he asked me to pray for him, for he had cancer. Yes, he had cancer. And after this conversation, this was followed by a few more phone conversations. We had a few more conversations after that. Now, what was interesting about this person's story is that he said that he was thankful to God for giving him cancer. I was like, am I hearing you right? And he said, yes, Brother Mike, you heard me right. I'm thankful to God for giving me this cancer. Well, at first, he was asking God the usual question, why? And he was crying and searching for answers. Well, eventually, the answers and purpose find its way to this person's heart. Then he told me that if not for his cancer, he would have not gotten serious about his relationship with Jesus. Without his cancer, he would probably be dead without hope and without God. He was now stronger than ever. Well, not bodily, of course, but spiritually, he was stronger. And I was saying hallelujah to this person. You know, God's power is made perfect in his weakness, in his sickness, reminiscing of what Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, right? And he told me that God is really good all the time, even, mind you, my dear brethren, even in his cancer. He was telling me, God is good all the time. And this person asked me, Brother Mike, what will I do to serve God? What will I do? And I told this person, and I read to him Acts 2:38. And I told him to use his life as a living testimony to tell about Jesus to his family, to his friends. And guess what? That's what he is doing right now. You know, I am humbled by this person's faith in Jesus. And honestly, I was deeply encouraged to be all the more zealous and be vocal about my faith in the Lord. For if this person can testify about Jesus while in bed, we can do even more. While this person is testifying Jesus, even with cancer, even if he cannot walk, then I must do even more, right? I must be ashamed of myself. I should be ashamed of myself if I'm not doing more than what this person is actually doing. Now, the answer, to answer and give you the secret of that minister in prison, I was telling you a while ago that I would be telling you about a secret. Now, the secret to that minister in that prison, why Job, Paul, Joseph, and this person I was just telling you can say that God is good all the time, even in bad situations, the answer, my dear brethren, is this. They have come to know the truth. They have come to know the truth, and they have come to really know God. This person with cancer, he was living a life to the fullest now, even with cancer, because he was able to find what the truth is all about. And he was able to find who God is. Same with Apostle Paul. Same with Job. Same with Joseph the dreamer. And same with that person in the prison, that minister in that person, in that prison. They have all found the truth. And the Bible said, and it is right, the truth will set us all free, free of misconception. And they have found who God really is, and that God is truly a sovereign God. If we have these two things, my dear brothers and sisters, we can say with absolute confidence and conviction that God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. Even in our sick bed, even if we are burdened with so many troubles, we can still find the goodness in God. Romans 8:28. All things work for good for those who are called according to his purpose and for those who have loved the Lord. Even if we are having so much trouble in life, up to this moment that we have this pandemic, we can still say that God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. We must use our time, we must use our life to present God to everybody, to all that we can, come across with. You know, we must tell our friends, our relatives, our family members the goodness of the Lord. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, if ever that you feel like burdened in your life, things are a bit gloomy, or you may have questions about your faith, about salvation, I encourage you to reach out. To reach out to someone in this congregation, to talk to the elders, or anybody whom you feel like talking to, and let them help you in your spiritual journey. If, however, after hearing this lesson, you are encouraged to accept Jesus in their life, here is my plea. Let your voice be heard now. You know, unmute that microphone and let your voice be heard and accept the Lord Jesus Christ. And let the elders, and I'm pretty sure that they are more than glad to pray for you, to baptize you, and guide you in your new life with Christ. I hope that we will all find the goodness in the Lord, whatever our life circumstances is, because God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. A blessed day to all of you. God bless us all. Good morning.